Hey Hope Valley, this is Megan. We had technical difficulties last Sunday and the sermon did not record. So I'm re-recording just the highlights for you right now. So if you're away for Labor Day weekend or you are serving in kids, you can catch up and you don't miss out on our Luke sermon series. Today, we are recapping Luke 6, 17 through 26. And we are gonna look at three things. What did Jesus say? What did it mean to the people who heard it for the first time? And then what does it mean for us today? Okay, let's jump in. So first we're gonna look at Jesus. He maps out this beautiful mirror, this call and response passage. And so instead of just reading it straight through, I'm gonna break it up and show you the mirror passage as we read it. So he gives you one blessing and then one woe, or an outcry of despair that match or that link together. Okay, so the first one, number one, blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Now the mirror passage for this in Luke 6 is, but woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. So what we see here are a few really important things right off the bat. Number one, real riches are the presence and peace of God, period, full stop. The second thing is that no earthly resource can be a substitute. So that's part of what the mirror passage is saying. And then lastly, we see that Jesus is in no way saying that having earthly resources is a bad thing. What he's saying is feeling like that's the purpose of your life, like amassing resources is the purpose of your life, or feeling like they're a substitute for the peace and presence of God. That's where we go wrong. Okay, so that's the first mirror passage. Number two, blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. The mirror passage being, woe to you who are full now, for you shall be hungry. I love this. So we see two things here. Number one, we see that sorrow in all of its various forms is temporary. The second thing is that feeling secure and satisfied, if without Jesus or away from Jesus, is very temporary, which any of us know who have bought a house, bought a car, or got a new job. We did that hashtag blessed Instagram post, and the next day we woke up with the work and the mess and the headache that that blessing had brought, or just how quickly it stopped solving all of our problems. Number three, let's look at the next mirror. Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you, revile you, and spurn your name as evil on account of the Son of Man. The mirror passage is, woe to you when people speak well of you, for so their fathers did of the false prophets. That burns. It's like, even if people are saying nice things about you, who else are they saying nice things about? That doesn't necessarily mean that Jesus is saying yes. So we see a few things here. Number one, being shamed for really following Jesus is temporary. Number two, a friend asked an insanely awesome question while I was getting ready for this sermon. She asked, I wonder how much we are really insulted because of the name of Jesus, or because of the way we have misrepresented him. Mic drop. So in light of that, let's commit to two things. Let's be willing to be truly shamed if it's really for following Jesus. Let's be ready, knowing it's temporary. And then the second thing is, let's fight for the church as a global community to walk in the kind of love, honor, service, and respect that's really worthy of Jesus. So those are the mirror passages we see. There are three back and forths. So now let's look at some just broad stroke observations. So the passage opens with Jesus coming down and speaking on a level place. And there are two big things about that. Number one, it's a picture of the incarnation, the virgin birth, that he walked all the way down from heaven and came down, even though he didn't have to. He could have sent an email or put a scroll in the ground that we're gonna dig up with the gospel on it, but he came down. And then the second thing is he spoke from a level place, which means he didn't leverage like an amphitheater to project what he wanted to say. And the interesting thing about this is that where Jesus and the disciples spoke from was often the equivalent of like a keynote presentation. It was like an illustration because they didn't have a projector behind them. Often they spoke from a place that underlined or emphasized what they were saying. And the unique thing is in first century Israel, a level place in writings and in poetry, and if you're going to speak from it, it meant despair, isolation, and depression. And so the unique thing is that not only did Jesus come down to be with them, he spoke this message about poverty and riches, shame and honor, from a place where he put himself with us, with them, in their pain, in their despair. So this is such a beautiful setting that we see him speak this from. So now what did it mean when they first heard it? In first century Israel, there was a common belief that if you were poor or physically suffering, that you had somehow earned it or was a consequence for sin. And Jesus confronts this right off the bat. And I love he's constantly confronting shame in all of our lives by saying, it's temporary. The where you find yourself right now is not a permanent state, not a permanent, this is a season. This is not a permanent place of being. Also, if you want to study more, look at Isaiah 5, because this beautifully echoes Isaiah 5. It's literally like Jesus shows up several hundred years after he inspired Isaiah to write that book. He takes what he told Isaiah in Isaiah 5 and he condenses it and gives the essential granular elements. It's almost like he's like, hey, listen, I give you a whole lot of instructions in Isaiah. What really matters is X, Y, and Z. It's beautiful. So if you want to study, look at Isaiah 5 and Luke 6. It's super cool. Now, the last thing that we see here that they would have heard when they first heard this is that the gospel does not always bring people out of earthly poverty, but it brings a new dignity and the promise of eternal liberation and reward, which is incredible. Now, for us today, what does it mean for us? I believe it invites us to a point, there's an invitation to switch our point of view in two ways. Often, our current point of view about how we define blessing is that blessings are health, wealth, or security. I believe that this passage invites us to understand and fiercely embrace that true blessing is knowing, trusting, and following Jesus, and embracing that our real reward is in heaven. I think the second invitation to switch our point of view is that I currently view a woe or despair or sorrow as lack, poverty, or rejection. And I believe this passage is inviting me and you to recognize that true sorrow, real sorrow, is separation from God, worshiping ourselves, and embracing things that don't really satisfy. So I believe that this week, let's reflect on that and not just say, oh, well, that's nice that Jesus said that to them at that time, but recognize that the invitation to us today is to switch our point of view, to view blessing differently, and to view suffering differently. Okay. In closing, I'm going to give you a few reflection questions to look at, okay? Number one, are you listening to Jesus and are you writing it down? If the disciples hadn't listened and wrote this down, we wouldn't be talking. And the invitation to listen to Jesus, write it down, and let the people around you be blessed by what you're hearing and learning did not end with the disciples. So number one, as a church, let's listen and write it down and let's let it matter. Number two, have I let my circumstances get in the way or make me feel excluded from the truth of the gospel? Or have I let someone make me feel excluded? What Jesus is saying, whether you are poor, struggling, dealing with chronic illness, dealing with a state of shame, he is saying it is temporary and you are included. And I am talking to you. So let's not exclude ourselves when Jesus included us, okay? The next thing is there something in my life that I think is permanent that Jesus doesn't? So often we're in a season and we project it out for the rest of our lives. It's going to be like this. I'm always going to struggle with this. This is going to be in my life. And what Jesus is saying, even if on this side of heaven, you do experience it for your whole life, this side of heaven is finite. And on the other side of heaven, it's not going to be there. He's going to wipe away every tear. So let's remember that the struggle and the pain we feel right now, all of us, that it's temporary. If in Christ, it's temporary. The last reflection question is, where have I struggled and embraced shame instead of recognizing that my season is separate from my identity in Christ? So this is a nuanced question from the second one. So often we look at our the position we're in, success or poverty or struggle, and we equate that to identity. And what the invitation today, underlying the entire message, is the invitation to come be children of God and to recognize that struggle and pain is temporary and it is not our identity. So today, let's hold those things before Jesus. Let's remember that he came all the way down. He spoke from a level place. He confronted shame and presuppositions. He invites us to a point of view switch. And he invites us to listen and write down the ways that he's redefining blessing and woes for us so that it matters to the people around us. I love you guys. I can't wait to worship with you this Sunday. If you're new to Hope Valley, you can check us out at Turn Hall Ballroom in the Tivoli Building, 900 Auraria Parkway. Come find me after the service. I'd love to introduce you to people and help you get connected. Have a great week.